Welcome back. So, if you're watching this on YouTube, then I recommend you check out my website. It's right here, www.danceofthecosmos.com. And if you're already on my website, then wonderful. You can disregard that because you're already there. Great job. Alright, so in this video, we're going to kind of take a little departure. I've been doing a lot of videos about the four dimensions and about how planets operate, things of that nature. Now, what I really want to talk about here, because I think it's important when we start getting into reading people's charts, doing readings and stuff, that we really think about our clients, and not just our clients, but our clients' perception. It's so important. And one big important thing that I'm really referring to here is what I call, you see the sigh, is the self-fulfilling prophecy. So you have to be very careful with what you say and how you say it. And usually when I start a reading, what I'm doing is I'm feeling out the client. You know, I'm using that right brain. I'm listening. I'm saying basic things. Like usually when I start a reading, a lot of times what I'll do is I'll start out just talking about the first dimensional things of what their chart is. For example, you know, we'll talk about what the ascendant is, you know, so you're in a Libra ascendant. So it's all about trade. It's all about diplomacy and being fair and stuff. And it also depends upon the chart, because if they have some other things that are not echoing this in the chart, I probably won't talk about it. I made a video on confluence. You should check it out. If there's not confluence, I might not, but I'll probably mention it because it's important, you know. So we'll just talk about like, okay, so yeah, your moon's nakshatra is here. Your rising sign is here. Your sun is placed here. You know, and so the idea is when I'm talking to them, I'm starting to get a feel for them. I'm getting a feel for how much they're buying into what I'm saying and how much they're going to like be hanging on my every word, because that's going to dictate really how much I'm going to want to tell them. And I know that sounds like maybe I'm holding back or something like that, but I'll tell you why. So now I want to get into the example of really this is what has charged me with this. This is because I came into astrology. When I was talking to my first astrology teacher, what he was telling me was that he had a client that came to him that had seen another astrologer, and this other astrologer had told this person that you have a poisonous seed in your house of marriage. That's an exact quote. And it might have been house of relationship, but it was poisonous seed. Ah! I mean, goodness gracious. So this person then went on to not trust any relationship that they got into after that point. You know, and this of course brings up a really good point was, I haven't seen this person's chart, so I don't know the answer to this question, but this brings up the idea of, was it the fact that this person actually had some afflictions going in their seventh house or their ninth house or in the Navamsa or wherever this person was looking, wherever that astrologer was looking, did the client actually have those afflictions there? Or is this just one thing that the astrologer saw? You know, was this Saturn in the seventh house? Was this Saturn in the ninth? Was this Rahu in the seventh? Something of that nature, that would make them say that. And so, but what happened is the perspective of the client, it becomes, is it because that was the case, that it was there astrologically and that was what was blocking them? Or was it the case that that's what the astrologer told them? And since the astrologer told them that, that changed their perspective. So they went into all their future relationships just ready to jump ship at the slightest whim or not trusting of the people that they met. So this is where I talk about the self-fulfilling prophecy, because if you see something in the chart, it's very important that you be very careful with how you word it. And so that's why when I say, like, I first start talking with people about, you know, let's say that they had some relationship questions. Well, first, let's talk about the fact that, you know, you're a Libra ascendant. You know, let's talk about the fact that you've got Revati as your moon's nakshatra. Let's talk about those things for a second. Let's let that set in, because at that point, I'm going to see, especially if they're like a Libra ascendant, we're going to talk about relationships. That's perfect. You know, then that'll really set it up for me to be like, okay, does this person look like they're just like they're ready for me to tell them something, and that's what they're going to go with, and they want to know. And some people are really impatient. Some people just want to know now. They want the answer. Some people already have the answer that they want in mind. But the point is that if you see that the person's just like, oh, wow, yeah, and they're kind of like in shock and awe of what I'm saying, I'm probably going to ease back what I'm going to say at that point. Now, let's say I saw the same thing. Let's say I saw something where that astrologer that said poisonous seed in the house of marriage. Let's say I looked at the same chart. Let's say everywhere I looked for marriage, when I was looking at the dark arca, which is just another indication of spouse. It's a Gemini's chart arca. You know, then I'm looking at Venus. I'm looking at the seventh house. I'm looking at the seventh from Venus. I'm looking at the seventh lord. Look at the ninth house. I'm looking at the ninth lord. I'm looking at the Navamsa. I'm looking in the Saptamsa chart. And I'm looking at all these different things, and they're all showing difficulties with relationships and stuff. And especially maybe they don't all show difficulties in relationships, but maybe the time periods that they're going through transits, Varshafal, and through Vimshottari Dasha are all showing these difficulties for the next 2 years, and it's going to get better after that. In fact, maybe it's a total polar opposite, where this year looks terrible, these 2 years look terrible, the next 2 years look excellent. So, from all perspectives, from all those timing methods, let's say that that's the case that I see. Would I say something like, you have a poisonous seed in the house of marriage? No. Something that I would say would probably be like, now is a time for you really to work on yourself, and really for you to determine, you know, what it is that you can bring to a relationship. What would it mean to make it? How would that make you feel to be in that relationship? What is it that you're looking for? And how can you get that? And what can you work on in yourself to bring those characteristics out so that you can be a great partner? You know, maybe we'll talk about the three parts of a relationship, right? The you, the me, and the we. So making sure that they're seeing that it's like, okay, are you being a little bit egotistical here? Are you being ego-centered and just like, are making your needs first? And are your needs even fulfillable? And well, we can also kind of get an idea of this if they've got the moon strongly aspecting Saturn. We'll talk about Lata Tati. That's a Lata Tati of Ashta. We'll talk about that at some point in the future. But the point is like, just get them grounded down to earth, you know, and then ask them, you know, okay, so when, like, what are you doing? I mean, how do you usually get into relationships? You know, what is your, what's been your experience? I mean, is it usually people that you meet at work? You know, is there a certain circle of friends where most of your relationships come from? Do you do dating sites? Do you meet people at the bar? That's, by the way, with nothing to do with astrology. You find someone at the bar, you're going to be dating a person that goes to bars. So just know that, be aware of, you know, maybe that's the problem. If that's where you're meeting, that's where you met your last boyfriend, was at a bar, then guess what? You know, yeah, and you have problems because he drinks too much. I mean, that's like, you know, you have to, you have to vet your client. You have to suss out the situation and find out where they are at. And then you're going to find out a lot about how they're going to listen to you, and how they're going to take in the information as you're telling them stuff. And so if they're just like, oh, so I have to wait 2 years to get in a relationship? No, it's like you want to get them in the perspective of like, work on yourself. I wouldn't say those exact words, but I would kind of hint towards that situation of like, what can you bring to a relationship? What can you do? Maybe you should seek counseling, you know, so that you can see where your issues are, you know, and do some relationship autopsy, like I've heard mentioned by Karen White of Divine Time Astrology. She's a relationship astrologer. She's really excellent. Yes, so it's very, 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 very important that you clue into if they're hanging on your every word. Because if they're hanging on your every word, that's kind of like a danger zone. Because then if what you're saying is wrong, what if you're doing a reading and let's say you just kind of glanced over it and you saw that a couple strong, just two things that looked difficult. And you didn't really dig into it. You didn't really look in the Saptamsa and the Navamsa. Maybe you only glanced over at Vimshottari Dasha, but you didn't really pay too much attention to it. You know, so then you're telling them something. Yeah, this is really, you know, Yeah, I don't see it. I think that, you should be single or something for a while. No, you just tell them, I think you should work on yourself. Or, like I would kind of suggested that before, you could come from the perspective of, maybe you should, what do you do to get in relationships? Well, maybe you should start going to, find things that you like and, go with those. Find some meetup groups. Do you like mountain biking? Well, find a mountain biking meetup group. Maybe find a singles mountain biking meetup group. So it's like counsel them, even though you're looking at it and you're saying that they're not going to meet somebody, maybe it's not all astrology. Maybe there's one little aspect, one little tiny thing, one little tiny indicator of relationship that you're missing out. Maybe you're just not seeing that, the planetary dasha of the time, the Vimshottari dasha of the time, is showing, actually, it's showing that, it rules the seventh from Venus, and maybe you're not paying attention to that. And maybe it's in a very good, maybe otherwise it didn't look like it had anything to do with relationships, but it rules the seventh from Venus. And then all of a sudden they have Venus transiting their first house here in a couple months. And so you're telling them not to look for a relationship. Oh, wait 2 years, work on yourself, If you're flat out with that, then they might miss that opportunity, or that might come around and they're gonna be like, oh, it's not real because the astrologer didn't say it was so. So be very careful with that. And then on the other hand, if you've got somebody who it really seems like they don't really, and you know that you can, and you've sensed this out, you've vetted this person, you sussed out the situation, you can see that they're like, okay, that's great. And maybe even let them know that, like, hey, but don't take my word for it, go live your life. Especially with relationships, holy moly, live your life. Don't rely on astrology for it. It's cool when it's right, and on that end, yes, I did predict for myself that I would be getting married the year that I'm getting married. And I said that when I was single, before I'd met this person. And I said that the year before, when I met this person, I said the year that I would meet this person that I was going to meet somebody. And some of the difficulties that were going to be along with it worked right out, just like with what I saw on the chart. A lot of it I saw in Varshafala, actually. So it's very fascinating what can be seen with astrology. But just realize that. Just pay attention to that client. See where they're clue into what they're like buying into, how much they're buying into, because there's two ends of that self-fulfilling prophecy. There's the negative one, like the poisonous seed in the house and the person who sabotaged their relationships afterwards. There's the other thing of telling somebody something really great, like you're like, oh yeah, next year you're going into Jupiter Venus period. Oh, that's going to be the most amazing time. You're going to meet the love of your life. It's going to be so absolutely wonderful. This person's going to fulfill all your needs. Maybe you don't say those exact words, and maybe they interpret that's what you're going to say. Because maybe Venus is exalted in the sign of Jupiter, and Jupiter itself is exalted. So you're just looking at that and you're like, oh, this is just going to be the most wonderful thing in the world. And it'll happen next February. And so, because that's when Jupiter Venus starts, right? And so, or maybe you just tell them that, yeah, during this period starting in February, but maybe they take it to mean that it's going to happen in February. So they're sitting there and December, and they're just eating potato chips and not doing anything because they're like, all I gotta do is wait till February and I'm gonna meet the love of my life, click my heels a couple times. Well, if you're talking about Jupiter Venus dasha, or even if you're talking about Venus Jupiter dasha, Venus represents the longest period in Vimshottari. In fact, Venus is a 20-year cycle in and of itself. And so a lot of times, so in Jupiter Venus dasha, I believe is 3 years long, and about the same for Venus Jupiter Maha dasha and Antardasha. So just realize that you're predicting a 2 year period, or I'm sorry, a 3 year period. So you might want to do a little bit more work and find out which of those periods is going to work best, by looking at the transits and everything else that's going on in the chart. But also not, if you see that they're just like lighting up, they're like, oh my gosh, I'm going to meet my love of my life, I'm going to get married and this whole nine yards. And maybe it's true, but what if it doesn't happen? What if it doesn't happen because something was wrong? Maybe their birth information was inaccurate. You know, maybe you were set, you see that in the chart, and maybe your gut was screaming at you, yeah, I don't think it's going to do that. Maybe you don't listen to your gut because their birth time is accurate. Because occasionally this stuff happens with people where they tell you 7 o'clock, and so you punch that and you're like, oh, he was born at 7:22, perfect. And you know, and maybe you asked them AM or PM, and maybe they said AM, but they meant PM. And you put it in there, and you find out a long time ago, long time later, you're like, oh my gosh, this person is a totally different ascendant. And then in the meantime, the moon has changed nakshatras, so it won't change the time. Yeah, it actually can change the time pretty significantly by moving around the zodiac that much, that 12-hour difference. Can change it. So maybe now it pushes that time that you were expecting them to go by a couple years. So point being, just be very mindful. Very, 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 very mindful of the way people are acting and reacting to the information that you are giving them, especially when you're making predictions for them, especially when it's on important things like love life, finances, getting a job, you know, all the big things in life, you know. I mean, if you're just predicting that they're going to get a hamster next year, or when the best time to get a new hamster is, or plant their garden, you know, I mean, not a big deal. But, so just be aware of that, because, I mean, if what the great prediction that you make for them doesn't come true, then all of a sudden they might be questioning themselves. Or maybe the thing was, this is the other case that can become true, when you're predicting like, you're going to get this wonderful job. Yeah, you're coming up to a period and everything. And so they're just thinking that like, oh, here it comes, you know, like the world is going to just bring me this job. And what the situation is, it's like, yeah, I told you would get that in December, that, you know, you had a great period coming for career and advancement, you know, a lot of 10th and 11th house transits going on, a lot of good 10th and 11th house transits going on, a lot of 10th, 11th house doshas going on, you know, a good looking Varsha fall year or two are coming up. So yeah, I mean, yeah, this time looks really good. This is time is prime for you to either move up the chain of your ladder or find a new job. And so if that person just sits there and like kicks their feet up on the desk, like, oh, okay, I'm going to get a promotion, you know what I mean? And guess what? They don't get the promotion. Why? Because they didn't put the effort in. You didn't look at their third house. You know, you didn't look at their second house, their third house, their sixth house. And kind of console them. And just, if you see something great in somebody's chart, you know, one of the best things that you can tell them is be like, get ready, you know, this is a white knuckle ride, you know, you're coming up on the time that's looking the best, and you need to prepare, you need to be get ready, because I don't want you to just go into this time period sitting on your hands waiting for things to come to you. I want you to be ready to go out and get it, you know. So if you say that and they're taking action and initiative within their own life, you don't have to worry about self-fulfilling prophecy. And then it becomes a matter of, did I get it because I put effort into it, or did I get it because the astrologer said? I would rather have somebody thinking they're getting it because they put the effort into it. So maybe all I actually did was just did pure counseling with them. So just be aware of that. Be aware that sometimes this happens, and I'll give you... because I'll give you the idea of what the perspective is of people sometimes. It's not always the case, but it can be. I'll never forget. So I've been studying astrology for 3 years. I went and did my yoga teacher training. It was a 28-day intensive. And when I went there, word got out. I wasn't even trying to spread the word. Word got out that I was studying astrology, and all these people flocked to me. I had 36 people in my class. I would say at least half the class came to me and wanted me to read their chart. And I would explain to people, I would say, hey, you know, I've only been studying astrology for 3 months. You know, I mean, there's a lot that, you know, I don't know. And you know what their response was, oh, okay, can you look at my chart? You know, people don't understand. It's like they think, sometimes what happens is people get this idea that if you've been studying astrology, or you know about astrology just because you're starting to read charts or something like that, people just automatically like, this person has become a vessel for the stellar bodies, for the energy that they create, and they are manifesting and flowing through this person, and whatever I ask them, they're going to tell me exactly what it is. Because people, if you're not studying astrology, you don't really know how complicated it is. You know, you're just, And so people, if you can read and analyze a chart and look and just be able to see which planets are where, people are just going to be like, oh my gosh, that's so crazy. When it's as simple as 9 dots and 12 boxes, if you ask me. And so just be aware that people look at you as an astrologer at times like you have all the answers, like that you hold all the cards for them. And so be aware when you see people, when you're seeing that, like you're listening, when you're talking to them, you're listening and you're being aware of how much is this person buying into the next thing that I'm going to say. And you're just sitting there when you're talking to them, you're just aware with that energy so that you know that, like, hey, I'm going to have to really counsel this person that not only, yeah, I'll tell them that this looks like the greatest time period. If I see something great, I'll try and always say, do the work. Never just say, sit and wait. Always be like, yeah, you've got this time period. It looks like it's going to be a decent time for finances. So maybe you scale back. If you see someone's really like leaning in and really getting in there, I'm like, oh yeah, oh yeah, finances are gonna look good, yeah, you know, but you're gonna have to work at it, you know, just throw that out there. Even though maybe it just looks like it's just this wonderful time period, all these yogas are getting activated and all these great things are gonna happen in their chart, but make them have to be aware. I'd rather have somebody come to be like, yeah, that was a great time for me, but it really just fell in my lap. I started working hard for it, but then I didn't even have to, and the next thing I know, I'm just getting rewarded 10 times more than I didn't even need to do all that extra work. I'd rather have them come back to me and be like, you told me to do too much work, than, it wasn't as good as you said it was going to be. I'd rather have them be like, it was better. So with that being said, and there's so many factors in astrology. There's also, like I mentioned earlier, could be a birth time issue that they're not aware of. A lot of people don't realize, most people in fact, I would say, most clients don't realize how sensitive birth time is, don't really understand why that's even important. So just be aware of that stuff. Just be aware of your clients and make sure they're not leaning into it too much and kind of brush them back. Make sure that they know if you're making predictions, you're doing prediction work in astrology, that you're educating them that they have to put effort into it. Especially if that really looks like the case. And then if it's something bad, you know, instruct them in other areas of their life. So if they're like, well, what should I do, man? I really hate my job. When am I going to get something better? And you see them going through all these bad, you know, second house phases of time. You're just like, well, you know, this is, you know, so looking for another job. If you're going through a bad, you know, time of managing your finances and a bad time of managing your responsibilities, and maybe a little bad for the 11th house too, of like the gains and the income and the increase and reaching, you know, a new level of achievement. If you see that it's poor time for those and they're wanting to get out of their job, you know, it's like, you know, maybe it should be like, well, why, what is it about your job that you don't like? You know, what would it mean for you to be happy at another job? What would that look like? You know, so ask them that and be like, well, you know, what is good about the job that you have? I mean, are you ready to quit job? Are you ready to be poor? You ready to be poorer than you are, because you're going to start there, you're going to have to do training, you know? So maybe you should spend a little more time with what makes you happy in life. You know, so if it looks like a poor time for them, you know, for 10th house things, second house things, 11th house things, then maybe you should counsel them about what house actually looks like it's getting most activated in the best way during this period. So, you know, if they're in Mercury Dosh and this is going on, be like, you know, what are your favorite activities? You know, what are your hobbies? Maybe you should spend more time focusing on the things that you like to do right now. You know, and we'll revisit the career issue. I would say revisit the career issue in like a year, let these things play out, but just spend more time having fun. You know, live for your weekend, live for your off time. Wake up an hour earlier, go to bed an hour earlier every day so that you have more energy in the morning. You know, find the things that you need to do, because life's not all about the work that you do. You know, so just take their, use the positive and, well, you know, take the positive, maybe tone it down a notch for them, let them know that they have to put effort into it. And then with the negative, Find the part of their chart that is looking good. So don't emphasize the negative. Don't just be like, oh, this is a terrible time for you financially. Just maybe counsel them about what it's a good time for. You know, counsel them towards what looks good in their chart, the skills that they have, the interests that they have, the things that they love. You know, think about if you were that person, what you would want to hear and what would be the best way to give them that information. So you always want to think about how you give information. That's really what this video is about. It's about giving information and being responsible for the things that you say to people, and realize that people put a lot of faith and trust, and they put a lot of their life behind our words, because sometimes they're paying. I mean, you come and see me, you're going to be paying, you know, right now my rate is $120 for a session. You pay $120, you're going to want some answers. You're going to be like, this guy better tell me. And then, or you might just be like, oh, he's going to give me, I'm paying $120, so he's going to give me the greatest reading. And, he's a Swami. I am not a Swami. I am nothing. I'm just a guy that loves astrology, loves studying it. And it just so happens that I'm good with people, I guess. And I like to make astrology videos. I love to talk about astrology. So why not do some readings and make a little income off of it, you know? Make it my life. Imagine that. Doing what you love to do for a living. That's my goal, and I think I'm going to end this video here. And thank you for listening. Once again, www.danceofthecosmos.com if you want to read more, and namaste.